walk. Oh, mainline, mainline, tell him what you want. Oh, mainline, mainline, tell him what you want. You can call him up and tell him what you want.
Yes, you can call him up and tell him what you want. My task is to read the scripture this morning, and we're going to come from Proverbs 3. And it reads as thus: My son, forget not my law, but let thy heart keep my commandments. For length of days and long life and peace shall they add to thee. Let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them up behind thy neck, write them upon the tables of thine heart. So shall thou find favor and good understanding in the sight of the God and man. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart, and lean not unto thy own understanding. In all thy ways acknowledge him, and he shall direct thy path. I've read you Proverbs 3, 1 through 6. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers and hearers and doers of his word. Amen.
Heavenly Father, we come before you at this time, Father God, recognizing that you are a living God and you are in control, Father God. And Father God, we thank you this morning, Father God, for allowing us to be in your presence, Father God. Father God, we ask this morning, Father God, that you bless each of us and bring us into one accord, Father God. Praying for our pastor who's not present, Father God, that you keep him and bless him, Father God. Bless his family, Father God. Father God, bless the members of this great church, Father God. Bless those, Father God, who are able to keep their eyes on you, Father God, and for those who don't know you, Father God, help us to help them to come to know you, Father God. Father God, given these peril times, Father God, help us to keep our eyes on you. Forgive us for our sins. Help us humble ourselves. Help us pray. Help us help each other. Father God, bless this worship service and just help us and help the service and help those around. Father God, we pray for your will to be done, because we know you are in control. It is in your Son, Christ Jesus, we honor and praise and thank you. Amen.
Amen. Let the church say amen again. Amen. Despite what we have been through and what we're going through, I got a feeling everything's going to be all right. I got a feeling everything's gonna be all right. Oh, I got a feeling everything's gonna be all right. Oh, I got a feeling everything's gonna be all right. It's gonna be all right, be all right, be all right. Oh, the Holy Ghost done told me everything's gonna be all right. Oh, the Holy Ghost done told me everything's gonna be all right. Oh, the Holy Ghost done told me everything's gonna be all right. It's gonna be all right, be all right, be all right. Oh, I got a feeling everything's gonna be all right. Oh, I got a feeling everything's gonna be all right. Oh, I got a feeling everything's gonna be all right. It's gonna be all right, be all right, be all right. It was at the cross, at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burdens of my heart side, and now I am happy. Oh, it was at the cross, where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart roll away. Oh, it was there by faith that I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Thank you. Amen. We truly honor and give thanks to God because he is truly good, and without him, we would be nothing. So we thank him for all the wonderful things that he's done. We thank you for being here today, for those that thought it not robbery to show up at the house of the Lord, that we'd be able to have praise and worship service once again, because he is truly worthy of all of our praise, and we come to worship him in spirit and in truth. I want to first of all say that I know that we're not live with our broadcast today, but I do thank those that showed up in their purple and even those that showed up in their I Love My Pastor shirts. This is not only breast cancer awareness, and I kind of cut the breast cancer off. I just say cancer awareness, because cancer is not limited to just women. Cancer happens even in animals, but cancer is a serious thing, and if you haven't gotten yourself tested, you need to, because some cancers can be prevented. But you have to take the necessary precautions and get with your doctor. Don't be scared of the doctor. God has given them gifts also so they can diagnose you and get you the treatment necessary so you won't be a victim of cancer, but you can become a survivor of cancer. So once again, Cancer Awareness Month is what we observe in October, and it also is Pastor Appreciation Month. So on behalf of the church, we appreciate you, Dr. Robert Earl Herring Sr. Let's give him a round of applause. Amen, amen. We know just like with our bodies, God is doing some work in his body. So we continually pray for him that he's able to be healed according to the will of God. I heard Deacon Brantley say that in his prayer. Everything that's done in our lives is according to God's will. So we have to be strong enough to accept even when God says no. We have our prayer requests, but God knows us better than we know ourselves. So sometimes he has to say no to us. So we thank God for everybody that is here. I didn't get a chance to get a thought for the day, but I still thank Sister Laura Smith that she sends those to us. But we want to continue to pray for our sick and our convalescent list. Continue to those bereaved families that have death in their family. We pray in advance for you all that have doctor visits this week. Those that, even if you have a test, if you're in school, I know some of us, you never get too old to be in school, even if it's Sunday school. We just want you to be prepared for those tests or those quizzes that come before you, and we pray God's blessings according to you. Right now, we want to prepare to collect our offering, so we're going to ask that all our tithers, those that are tithing this week, to please stand with us. And then we're going to have our sowers, that should be everybody, to stand along with us. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Fathers, we come to you, thanking you for all that you have done, for all that you are doing, and all that you have in our future. We thank you right now that you've given us this privilege to give. You say the tithe is what we owe and the offering is what we sow. So, Father, we want you to continue to bless us financially, both collectively and individually. And we bring all of this back to you, God. You say if you give us the tenth unto you, that you provide all our needs with the 90% that's left over. So we stand faithful, believing upon your word, God, that you would do exactly what you said you would do. These and other blessings we ask in thy son Jesus' name, and for his sake we pray. Thank God and amen. Amen. Why are you yet still standing? You know, I had to get you. I don't want you to bend those knees yet unless you're going down to bow in prayer. Our scripture text is coming from Mark chapter 5. Mark chapter 5 is going to begin at verse 22. Take your time, we're in no hurry. Mark chapter 5, beginning at verse 22. And then we're going to jump from 20, we're going to read 22 through 24. Then we're going to jump down to verse 35 and 36, okay? So we're going to start Mark chapter 5, verse 22 through 24. Then we're going to jump down to 35 and 36. So let's start back up at the top, Mark chapter 5, verse 22. It says, "And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet and besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she shall live." And Jesus went with him, and much people followed him and thronged him. Then let's go down to verse 35 and 36, which say, while he yet speak, there came from the ruler of the synagogue's house certain which said, thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any further? As soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only believe. The word of God for the people of God. You may have your seats. And we are privileged right now to have the speaker for this morning. He is no unfamiliar person to all of us that are here, but just for those that may receive this through way of broadcast, he's not only our trustee, our chairman of our trustees, but he's a good man of God that comes with the word of God. So after the next election from the choir, we will have our speaker for this morning, Brother Terrence Wright, Sr.
grateful. In the midst of it all, we still have to be grateful, amen? Because God is in control. Good morning, Mount Bethel. It's an honor and a privilege to be before you this morning. For those who are viewing via stream, I can't see you, but glad you're there. Give honor to God. Give honor to Pastor Herring, the angel of this house. Sister Herring is First Lady. To all of you, members and friends of Mount Bethel, glad to see you this morning. I'm always counted an honor and a privilege when Pastor gives me this opportunity to come before you and break the word of life. So I don't take it lightly. I don't take it for granted. And I'm just glad to be here. Amen. So without any farther ado, before that, let me also say I'd like to acknowledge my wife, Sister Regina Wright, best defense attorney in the state of Florida, amen? If you don't know, you better ask somebody. They will surely tell you. She's been a great support, and she's been with me a long time. I met her in college, amen? So that's been many, 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 many years ago. And it's still there. But without any further ado, let's go to God in prayer. Lord God, we thank you this morning, Father. Thank you for our opportunity, Lord, just to be in your house one more time, Father. Thank you, God, for your grace, which is sufficient, and your mercy, Father, which you say is everlasting. Father, I just pray, Lord, that as I come before your people this morning, Lord, that you will use me as a conduit, Lord. That you will open my heart and my mouth, Father, to receive that which you give me, to give to your people. Father, I pray, Lord, that you will break up the fallow ground, Lord, and allow anyone who's listening to the message, Father, to receive just what you would have them to receive, Father. Father, we don't come here for form or fashion, Father, but we come here from a word for you to change our lives, Father. So, Father, we just pray now, Lord, that you have your way in our lives and that your will be done, Father. Father, deliver where there, send deliverance where there needs to be deliverance. Father, send healing where there needs to be healing. Father, send peace where there needs to be peace. Most of all, Father, we just pray, Lord, for the salvation of those that don't know you and the pardon of their sins. And so, Father, we pray all these things in your Son Jesus' name. Amen. Amen, amen, amen. And so, if there was ever a time the people of God needed faith, it is now. We're living in a tumultuous time. Violent crime, record unemployment, widespread financial distress, and a deadly, incurable airborne virus, COVID-19, surrounds us. You may not be able to hug, visit, or even see your loved ones in some cases. People are putting their very lives on the line every day just to go to work and make a living. We have to be careful not to lose heart, though, and allow our faith to be shaken by the many things that's going on around us. Our faith in God must remain strong, because where there's no faith, fear and dismay will take over. So I come to you this morning to encourage you from the title of Faith, Don't Fail Me Now. Faith, Don't Fail Me Now. And if I had to have a subtopic, it would be Only Believe. Faith, Don't Fail Me Now, Only Believe. And so we pick up the text here where Jesus and the disciples have just left the country of Gadarenes. And while they were there, they encountered the man in the tombs, the man that was demon-possessed, that nobody could do anything with, that he was naked and crazy and running around. And they say when Jesus landed that he ran to Jesus and Jesus healed him. Jesus cast out the demons. And so we find that Jesus has cast out the demons. The people have asked him to leave, and he's back in the boat, and he's going back across the water. But before we leave, I just come to encourage you one time, even from that scripture. Because even though he found the man, when he met him, he was naked and crazy, amen. But when he left him, he was clothed and in his right mind, amen. So you know what that means, D? That means that he'll meet you where you are, but he won't leave you how he found you, amen. Yes, Jesus passed back over to the other side, and when he gets off the boat, a crowd has gathered. And that brings us to our text. Starting at verse 21, it says, "And when Jesus was passed over again by the ship unto the other side, much people gathered unto him, and he was nigh unto the sea. And behold, there cometh one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And when he saw him, he fell at his feet, and besought him greatly, saying, My little daughter lieth at the point of death. I pray thee, come and lay thy hands on her, that she may be healed, and she will live." So there are some things that, as we talk about faith don't fail me now, that I thought this was a very fitting story, because the first thing I see when I read this passage is Jairus' desperation. He's in a desperate situation. You ever been in a desperate situation? And what I mean by a desperate situation is Jairus, keeping in mind that it said he was a ruler of the synagogue, meaning that he was a man of position, he was a man of prestige, he was a man of power, he was a man of influence and affluence. But out of all those things he had, his daughter lived at the point of death, and none of those things could help him. But what Jairus did realize and recognize is that Jesus could help him. He had faith in the fact that if I could get to Jesus, Jesus can help my daughter. And so even though he was a man of power, prestige, and influence and affluence, he comes to Jesus, but he doesn't come to Jesus out of his affluence. He doesn't come to Jesus out of his influence. He comes humbly, no pretenses. It says he falls at his feet. He collapses at the feet of Jesus. This is a ruler of the synagogue. You know, this would have been frowned upon by the members of the synagogue, but his daughter is at the point of death. He don't care. The only thing that's important to him is Jesus can heal his daughter. And so Jairus comes to Jesus and he pleads his case, and Jesus says that he'll come with him. And so Jesus and Jairus sets off for his house. Can you imagine? You have this desperate situation. You have faith that Jesus will do it. Jesus agrees to do it. You're on the way to your house. I just can imagine, you know, that Jairus was just doing the happy dance. You know, this is when we get that word from God and we show up at church. You know, the Sunday and everything that happened. Oh, you know, we there. Jesus is with us. Jesus is coming to my house. He go take care of my situation. But, you know, you hear but. We skip verses 25 through 34 in the scripture, because that's really not what I want to talk about, but I can't talk about Jairus without at least weaving this in a little bit. So this is the story that we all are familiar with, the woman with the issue of blood. And so how this ties in is Jairus, just, you know, he happy, he doing the dance, and Jesus coming to him, you know, make way, get out the way. You know, they walking through the crowd because they said it was a big crowd. Can you see him? He moving everybody out the way, and Jesus stops. Jairus still going, I would imagine, using my imagination here. He's still going, but Jesus had stopped. And Jairus looked back. Now he's in a desperate situation. My daughter lays at the point of death. We need to hurry up. He comes back and Jesus is standing there saying, somebody touch me. What? All these people out here? We walking through a big crowd? Somebody touched you? And Jesus finds out that, you know, well, he didn't find out, he knew it. The lady touched him, say she had been hemorrhaging for 12 long years. She touched him, he felt the virtue go out, she felt the virtue come in, and Jesus stopped to address that situation. So Jairus comes back, and the reason that this is important to this story is because I want to talk a little bit about waiting. Because even though Jairus is in a desperate situation, Jesus is with him, he's going to his house, but they get interrupted by this woman who has another situation. Jesus stops to help this lady, and Jairus has to stand there and watch someone else get blessed while he's desperately waiting on a blessing. Amen? He has to stand there while his daughter is dying and Jesus on the way to his house and watch this other person get blessed. Pastor calls this time, if he was here, the meantime. He says there's a seen time, a sad time, and a seen time, and in the meantime is the meantime. And the meantime is a very mean time. It's the time of waiting. If Sister Erin was here, she would say that it's the wait, W-E-I-G-H-T, of the wait, W-A-I-T. Because it's a desperate situation. Just when I thought I had it under control, he gets stopped. So I come to ask you a question. Because as I read the text, I don't know how Jairus waited, but I know he waited. So let me ask you this. How many blessings have you missed out on because you couldn't wait? Because no matter what was going on, Jairus stayed there till Jesus finished. Now in his mind, he might have been telling Jesus off, but guess what? He stayed right there. But so often what we do is, we got a word from Jesus, we came to church, we did the dance, and Jesus doesn't come through and we think he ought to come through, and we don't wait, and we miss the blessing. We miss the blessing because we don't wait. And on the second point, which I had to mention is, while you're waiting, can you celebrate with that other person that got blessed? Yeah, you're waiting, but, you know, I guess they say if Jesus is blessing your neighbor, that means he's in the neighborhood, amen? So he's in the blessing business. And see, it's important because this is really the issue that I was trying to get at, because we never know what Jesus is up to. This is why we have to trust him. Because even though Jairus is there and he's waiting and he has to watch this other miracle, what I realize is that Jesus has allowed Jairus to witness a miracle while he's waiting on a miracle. This is how he strengthens our faith. This is why that's why we can't get impatient with waiting, and we can't, you know, because God knows. He's omniscient. He's omnipotent. He's omnipresent. He knows what's going on. We have to trust him that whatever's going on, you got it, God. Because he allows him to witness while he's waiting. And what happens is, as while he's witnessing and waiting, bad news comes. Bad news comes. It says that, wait a minute, let me find it. It says that Oh, I done knocked it down. Okay. That while he's waiting, while he's yet waiting, someone from the house. All right. I knocked my iPad off, y'all. This is why you should use the Bible. Okay, let me get it back up. Okay, here we go. So it says, while he yet spake, there came from the ruler of the synagogue certain house which said, thy daughter is dead. Why troublest thou the master any farther? Thy daughter is dead. I was waiting. Jesus was coming. I had to wait. He was going to heal her, but now she is dead. Now, I come to tell you this morning that I don't think that they were right. And what I mean by they were right is, why would they come to him with that? But you say, Brother Wright, it's right. I mean, it's a fact. You know, but let's look at it. It's because they didn't have to say what they said. Amen? What do you mean, Brother Wright? Because I see y'all staring at me like I'm crazy or something. But so I'm going to show it to you. They didn't have to say what they did. You have to be careful of they. You have to be careful of they. They will kill your faith. You see, they never stick to the facts. Watch this. If they would have said, thy daughter is dead, that would have been okay because that is a fact. But that's not what they said. They added their advice to the end. They said how he should handle the situation. Why troubleth thou the master any farther? In other words, man, it's over. Let's go home. Get some fried chicken and check sodas. The deal is done. This is the problem with they. They often get the truth mixed up with the facts. The fact is, she was dead, but the truth is, Jesus had already said, I got this. The reality is, the reason we are all in church today is there is a difference between fact and truth. The fact is, we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. The fact is, the wages of sin is death. The fact is, we all ought to be going to hell with gasoline draws on, because the truth is, because of the blood of Jesus. As soon as they gave him the bad news and their advice, Jesus immediately intervened and said, don't fear, keep on believing. Don't fear, keep on believing. Keep on faithing. Faith, don't fail me now. Amen? And so we look at verse 36, and it says, as soon as Jesus heard the word that was spoken, he saith unto the ruler of the synagogue, be not afraid, only believe. In some translation it says, don't fear, have faith. Do not be afraid, have fear. And that's really what I want to talk about today, because like I said, these are tumultuous times, things happen, and it's easy to lose your faith. It's easy to lose heart, just like Jairus. Jairus' faith was shaken by what he heard. How do I know? Because Jesus said, have faith. Don't fear. Don't fear. Don't fear. Fear is the opposite of faith. Fear and faith cannot exist at the same time. They cannot occupy the same space. So if Jesus is telling him not to fear, that means that he is losing his faith. And so Jesus attempts to get Jairus to hold on to his faith. Faith, don't fail me now. In verse 24, Jairus was full of faith. He was doing the happy dance. Jesus, come into my house. What happened? Right? What happened? He came to Jesus in faith. He came to Jesus because he felt like he could heal his daughter. Jesus said he was coming. He had faith that he was going to heal his daughter. Now, two verses later, we find that Jesus is encouraging him. Man, hold on to your faith. Keep believing. What happened? And this is the point I want to drive home today. How did he go from faith to fear so quickly? The circumstances changed. The circumstances changed. The text says he was waiting on the healing. Jesus agreed to come do the healing. Everything in his mind was this healing was about to happen. Well, now somebody come and say, your daughter is dead. And so he loses faith because the faith that he had, the object of the faith had gone away. The object of the faith was the healing. Well, she's dead. So what am I believing in? Amen? However, catch this. He walking with Jesus, right? So they come and they say, your daughter is dead. However, Jairus is walking with Jesus. He's standing right there with Jesus when the news comes to him. Anybody ever walk with Jesus? I mean, if you're walking with Jesus, if there's ever a time that you ought to feel secure, it's when you're walking with Jesus. I'm talking about Jesus, y'all. Jesus, the Son of God. Jesus, who healed the sick. Jesus, who cast out devils. Jesus, who speak to the storms and they obey. Jesus, who walks on the water. Jesus, who he just witnessed perform a miracle moments earlier. Yet, he still allows fear to come in and take over because the circumstances has changed. Faith, don't fail me now. Why is it when the circumstances or the outcome we are expecting changes, it shakes our faith? Why is that? Because our faith is misplaced. That's why it shakes our faith. It shakes our faith because our faith is misplaced. We have put our faith in the expected outcome instead of Jesus himself. Because as long as you had your faith in Jesus, as long as Jesus is with you, it doesn't matter what the circumstances are. But so often, we put our faith in the circumstances. Circumstances will let you down every time. Every time. Jesus never will. He's bigger than any circumstance. Circumstances are just distractions that keep you from focusing on Jesus. Have faith in the man, not in his hands. Have faith in Jesus, not what you think he can do for you. We know the story. It's what happened to Peter. He sees Jesus out on the water, bid me to come. Come on, Peter. He gets out the boat. As long as his attention is on Jesus, he's okay. As soon as the water started getting rocky, he started looking at the water. He what? He begins to sink because he put his faith at that point in the circumstances instead of keeping his faith on Jesus, who told him to get out on the water in the first place. That's what we have to remember in these tough times, y'all. Time's going to be tough. Circumstances are going to change. The enemy has control of the circumstances. He can make circumstances change. But we have to put our faith in God. And then the circumstances doesn't matter. Because you know what? The Bible says that he can make all things work together for your good. So whatever the circumstances are that come,
Jesus can take it and work it out and make it for your good. So you have to have the faith in Jesus, not in the circumstances. Jesus is sovereign. He can do whatever he wants to do, when he wants to do it, to whom he wants to do it. All things on, under, and above the earth are subject to him. He is in total control of everything. Our faith should be in Jesus. Verse 36 goes on to say, not only he told him two things. He told him, fear not. But then he also told him, only believe. Only believe. Let's look at that. That word believe is from the Greek root word pisteo. You may have also heard the word pistis, which means faith. Comes from that same root. It basically means to be persuaded as true. It's a verb that commands repeated, continual action. So he's not saying, Jairus, only believe. He's telling Jairus, keep believing, man. Hold on. Keep the faith. Don't let it go. Keep believing, man. Keep it going. See, because he believed at one point. So if believing it wasn't the issue was to keep believing. And if we're honest with ourselves, we find ourselves in this situation all the time. You believe God for something. The hard part is to keep believing in the face of circumstances. But if we put our faith in Jesus, that's the key. Don't worry about the circumstances. Don't worry about the circumstances. Put the faith in Jesus, not the circumstances. Keep believing. Faith don't fail me now. In other words, don't listen to what they say. Remember who I am. That's what God was telling him. Don't worry about what they say. They say all kind of stuff. Just keep remembering who I am. If you keep remembering who I am, it will always help you to overcome what they are saying. Abraham gives us a great example in Romans chapter 4. Let's look at that right quick. I had to turn in the Bible no other time, so give me one. Give me one time. In Romans chapter 4, when we talk about Brother Abraham, starting in verse 18, it says, Abraham, who against hope, believed in hope, that he might become the father of many nations. Remember, he didn't have no kids at this time. According to that which was spoken, God made him a promise that he would be many nations, even though he didn't have a kid. So shall thy seed be. And being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old, father of many nations, no kids, he's now 100 years old. 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb. So he didn't consider that. He considered not. He didn't consider that. He didn't consider the circumstances. Those are the circumstances, right? He said, you're going to have a kid, but I'm 100 years old, and my wife's womb is dead. But he said he didn't even consider that because God gave him a word. Amen? And being not weak in faith, considered not his own body, now dead, when he was about 100 years old, neither yet the deadness of Sarah's womb, here we go, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. Only believe. He struggled, he staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief, but was strong in faith, giving God the glory. Here we go. And being fully persuaded, right? Being fully persuaded, that means you can't change my mind. I know what I know, what I know. And being fully persuaded that what he had promised, he was also able to perform. Amen. Reverend James would say it like this. He staggered not at the promise because he stared not at the circumstances. He kept his eyes on Jesus. He know what God had told him. I don't care what's going on. I know what God told me. That's what I'm going with. Keep on believing. Keep the faith. And so, again, I come to tell you this morning because I know sometimes when we get away from here and things come up and it's easy to get discouraged and as I prayed and I was asking God, you know, what I should speak about, and this is the passage that jumped out at me. So I know this word is for somebody. I know it is for somebody. And so if you don't remember anything else, and when you get home and somebody say, well, what did the preacher preach about? If you don't remember anything else, hold on to your faith. Only believe. Faith don't fail me now. Only believe. And so I'm not going to leave you there. As I close, we'll talk about the rest of the story, because I'm saying don't worry about the circumstances, but I can't leave Jairus with his daughter dead. Amen. And so if you read the rest of the story, verses 37 through 42, it says that after Jesus told him, don't fear, only believe, he said he took Peter, James, and John, three of his disciples. He left everybody else. He took those three, and they set out to Jairus' house. Amen? And when they got to Jairus' house, they found people standing around. They say they was wailing and weeping. You know, they had these professional mourners back then that you could pay, and they would come out and mourn it and wail at your house. And Jesus comes in, and he says, why such ado? Why are you all making such a big deal out of this? She's not dead. She's only asleep. Now, a minute ago, Brother Wright, so you're contradicting yourself. You know, this is what unbelievers say when they catch you in the streets and they think they found something different. You said that her being dead was a fact. Well, it is a fact, but I also told you that the truth and the facts don't always get together, because the fact was she is dead, but the truth is now Jesus was in the room and he know that this is a temporary situation, because he has the power and authority to raise her up. So he said, she's only asleep. Never let the facts stand in the way of the truth. Because he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. The truth and nothing but the truth. See, that's what faith sounds like. That's faith talk. That's what faith sounds like. And then it says, as unbelievers and carnal Christians would do, it said they laughed in the scorn. What that means, y'all, is they laughed in his face. But you know what he did? He put them out. See, sometimes when you have a dead situation, the reason that you can't get that thing back alive, you got to put some people out. People who don't believe what you believe, you got to put them out. Faith requires faith. You can't have some faith mixed with some unbelief. Put them out. And it says after Jesus put them out, he gathered the family around. He gathered the disciples. He gathered the mom. He gathered the dad and said, he took her by the hand and he said, Talitha kumai, which means damsel, arise. And it says that she stood up. Life, breath came back in her body. Oh, man. See, he looked at an impossible situation. Then Jesus spoke to the situation. He looked at the dead girl and said, Talitha kumai, girl, arise. Breath came back into her body. She got up out of that dead situation, right? So he's able. That's what we have to remember. He's able. He's above circumstances. I'm so glad that we serve a God who can speak to any dead situation and make it come back alive. Because that means he can speak to your finances, amen, and say, Talitha kumai. He can speak to your dead relationships and say, Talitha kumai. He can speak to your dead dreams He can speak to your dad's employment. He can speak to your dad's visions and hopes. And he can say, Talitha Koma, and they will get up. I'm so glad that he's able to bring death out of life, because one day on a hill called Calvary, they killed them, y'all. And after they killed him, he went in the grave for one night. He stayed there all night Friday night. He stayed there all night Saturday night. But early Sunday morning, he got up with all power in his hands. And because he got up with all power in his hands, don't let your current circumstances shake your faith in the Almighty God. God has power that is not limited by circumstances. I don't know what's going on in your life, but whatever life brings your way, don't let the facts get in the way of truth. Don't let the facts get in the way of truth. Remember, faith, don't fail me now. Fear not. Hold on to your faith. Trust him. He won't let you down. Only believe. Only believe. Only believe. Only believe.
Amen. Come on, y'all, stand to your feet. Amen. I've said that some long time ago, Terrence. You got to stop listening to what they say. Because Jesus had already told Jairus if he was coming to the house so she would live, not that she would die. And the way Terrence said it was because the circumstances, but I use a different word. I say your happiness. His happiness went out. When Jairus got that bad news that she was dead, he stopped being happy because he was listening to what they say. You can't listen to what they say. When Jesus already said it, I believe it, that settles it. Whatever's going on in your life right now, Jesus already spoken over your life. But you got to stand fast, just like Terrence just told us, and you got to be able to believe what God has said in spite of what they have to say about it. Stop listening to what they have to say. Because they don't have the power that Jesus has. You see a situation as being dead. Jesus sees a situation as being asleep. And he can wake you up from your sleep. You got to be able to trust him. And that starts right now. You got to be able to trust what God has said concerning you. So we're going to extend an invitation to you right now. Now whether you watch this broadcast later, it still applies to you when you get this message. That you got to have faith and you got to believe what God has said concerning you. So as we extend this invitation, we invite you to come. You may come by letter, Christian experience, or a candidate for baptism. But just like Peter did when Jesus extended the invitation to him, you got to come. Brand new, for he will take care of you. Come to Jesus while you have time. Come on, let's sing it one more time. Come unto Jesus while you have time. Come unto Jesus while you have time. Come unto Jesus, make up your mind, he will make your life brand new, for he will take care of you. Come to Jesus while you have time. Amen, amen. We thank God for this opportunity to be here and to witness his word. I tell you, we thank God also because we have no shortage of preachers here at Mount Bethel. Even though our pastor is out, we still have preachers here to bring the word of God. So we thank Brother Terrence, right? Let's give him a hand. Thank you. Amen, amen. And we thank God for him. We thank God for using him in a mighty way. And when you look over this message again, do not be afraid. Just believe. Because God has said, and as Terrence was talking, I pointed at my watch. I wasn't telling him time was up. I was telling him we need to stop looking at our watches. Because if God said it, God is sovereign. That means he could do what he wants to do, with whom he wants to do, whenever he wants to do it. But if he said it, he will bring it to pass. Amen. We like to close out all of our services in prayer. So let's go to the Lord in prayer before we dismiss. Father God, as we come to you right now, first of all, we'd like to thank you for the word. We'd like to thank you for your word, because your word still stands. It's not about what they say, it's about what you say. And we thank you for the vessel that you used, the vessel that our chairman of our trustees and Brother Terrence Wright. Thank you for giving him a rhema word, a word for right now, God, that we can use not just today, but we can use in our future. Whenever the devil tries to take our happiness, we got to know that our happiness is based on what's happening. So even though J. Ira's circumstances changed and it took away his happiness, nobody can take away our joy. Because it's not about our happiness. It's about a joy that you've given us that the world didn't give and the world cannot take away. So as we leave these four consecrated walls, God, we want you to look on our prayer list. Look on those that have already cast prayers as we stand as intercessors for them. Look on us individually and collectively. You know what we need, and you are the great shepherd. You are the chief shepherd. You are a good shepherd. So as we leave this place, we do not leave from your presence. So keep us and guide us and strengthen us is our prayer. Now may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the sweet communing of his Holy Spirit, may it rest, rule, and abide with his people both now and forevermore. And the saints of God said, amen for the Father, amen for the Son, and amen for the Holy Spirit. You are dismissed, and God bless.